Hello everyone, this is the history tutorial video for class 10. In the previous video we were doing nationalism in Indochina. We had started this chapter, but since that chapter altogether has been removed from the board syllabus, we are directly moving on to the next chapter, which is nationalism in India. We will study about the freedom movement in India, the nationalist movement in India. So let's begin. Now, as you have seen, modern nationalism has meant in Europe, it has meant formation of nation states. It also meant a change in people's understandings about who they were and what defined their identity and their sense of belonging. In India, like in Vietnam and many other colonies at that time, the growth of modern nationalism is intimately related to the anti-colonial movement. So it's very intimately connected with the freedom movement of India. People began discovering their unity in the process of their struggle with colonialism. The sense of being oppressed under a colonialist government provided a shared bond that tied many groups of people together. But each class and each group felt the effects of colonialism, felt the effects of British government differently. Their experiences were different, their notions were not always the same, their ideas of freedom were not always the same. Now, the Congress under Mahatma Gandhi, they tried to forge these groups together within one movement. We will see how far it was successful. In the years after 1919, we see the national movement spreading to new areas, incorporating new social groups and developing new modes of struggle. How do we understand these developments? What implications did they have? First of all, the First World War, created a new economic and political situation. It led to a huge increase in defense expenditure. The cost of maintaining and providing for an army, a huge army, and all the weapons, maintaining those weapons, buying new weapons, so it adds to the expenditure of maintaining the army. So a huge defense expenditure was built, which was financed by war loans and increasing taxes. So war loans were taken from the League of Nations, taxes were increased on the Indian people, customs duties were raised, and income tax was introduced. For the first time, income tax was introduced. Through the war years, prices increased. It was very common in any part of the world that during war, prices in the market would increase. Prices of the products, prices of food grains, etc., basic needs, that will increase. Villages were called upon to supply soldiers, and the forced recruitment in rural areas caused widespread anger. So there were forced recruitments, villages were drafted, large number of village people, able-bodied, strong men, young men, they were drafted into the army forcibly. Then in 1918 or 19, crops failed in many parts of India. So there was a crop failure in 1918 and 1919, resulting in acute shortages of food. And these shortages of food led to a famine. Also, along with the famine, there arose another disease called influenza. So influenza came along with the famine. It was an epidemic. According to the census of 1921, according to the population survey of 1921, 12 to 13 million people died as a result of famine and influenza. People had hoped that the hardships, the difficulties in life would end after the war, but that did not happen. Now, in 1915, Mahatma Gandhi returned to India from South Africa. You know what he did in South Africa, how he protested against the British government over there by applying a new method of protest called the Satyagraha. The idea of Satyagraha suggested that if the cause was true, if the struggle was against injustice, then physical force was not necessary. Without seeking revenge or without being aggressive, a Satyagrahi could win the battle through non-violence. This idea of non-violence was the main inspiring theme for the Indian national movement after Mahatma Gandhi came back to India. After arriving in India, Gandhi successfully organized Satyagraha movements in all parts of the country. First, in 1916, he traveled to Champaran in Bihar to inspire the peasants to struggle against the oppressive plantation system. So the farmers in Bihar, Champaran, they were having problems with the plantation owners. They were having problems with the oppressive system of plantation. So Mahatma Gandhi went there and he organized his first Satyagraha in India. Then in 1917, he went to the Kheda district of Gujarat. Kheda is a district in Gujarat where Gandhi went in 1917. The farmers in Kheda, they were affected by the famine, they were affected by the influenza epidemic. They were not able to pay the taxes, they were not able to pay the revenue, and they were demanding that revenue collection for that year would be relaxed. So Mahatma Gandhi went there and organized another Satyagraha. In 1918, Gandhi went to Ahmedabad to organize a Satyagraha movement among the cotton mill workers. So Mahatma Gandhi's organizational skills were not only limited to farmers, now he also extended his Satyagraha movement to the workers. Cotton mill workers in Ahmedabad was helped by Mahatma Gandhi organize a Satyagraha. Now, emboldened with this success, three successful Satyagraha movements in 1916, 1917 and 1918 in Champaran, in Kheda and in Ahmedabad. So Mahatma Gandhi was emboldened by this success. In 1919, Gandhi decided to launch a nationwide Satyagraha, a countrywide Satyagraha against the proposed Rowlatt Act. Now, what is Rowlatt Act? Rowlatt Act has been hurriedly passed through the Imperial Legislative Council despite the united opposition by the Indian members. It gave the British government enormous powers to repress political activities and allow arrest of political prisoners without trial, without warrant, for 2 years. So what was this Rowlatt Act? Number one, it gave the government enormous powers to beat up the political activists or break apart the political organizers or organizing movements in any way they seem fit, in any way they want. And number two, this act allowed the arrest of a political prisoner without any warrant and detention of that particular prisoner without any trial in police custody for 2 years. So Gandhi wanted a non-violent civil disobedience against such unjust laws, which would start with a Hartal strike on 6th April. On 6th April 1919, Gandhi organized a nationwide strike which would start a movement based on non-violent lines. Rallies were organized in various cities, workers went on strikes in railway workshops, and shops closed down. So this Hartal, the call for Hartal by Gandhiji, was met with very much popular acceptance from the people, from the Indian people. Alarmed by the popular upsurge and scared that lines of communication would be disrupted, the British administration decided to clamp down on nationalists. So the British the British government, they decided to repress this popular upsurge suddenly, clamp down on nationalists. They would repress, they would suppress these national uprisings or movements, nationalist movements. Local leaders were arrested from Amritsar, and Gandhi was banned from entering Delhi. On 10th April, the police in Amritsar fired upon a peaceful procession, provoking widespread attacks on banks, post offices and railway stations. Martial law was imposed and General Dyer took command. Now, on 10th April, what happened? A peaceful procession was out. Police fired on the peaceful procession. It broke apart. And as a revenge, people started looting banks, attacking post offices, railway stations, etc. The places which was a symbol of government office, right? Post offices were under the government, railway stations were working under the government, banks were under the government. So places which symbolized the government were attacked. Martial law was imposed. Martial law means that a curfew. So a curfew was imposed and General Dyer took command of the situation. General Dyer arrived, and on 13th April, what happened was the infamous Jallianwala Bagh incident. On that day, a large crowd had gathered in the enclosed ground of Jallianwala Bagh. So Jallianwala Bagh was an enclosed field where lots of activities would have been organized, would be organized. So some came to protest against the government's new repressive measures. Some had come to attend the fair, the annual fair. Being from outside the city, many villagers were unaware about the martial law that has been imposed. So General Dyer, he got the news of this procession. He got the news that this the people have arrived in this ground called Jallianwala Bagh. They are organizing something. Now Dyer, what he did, blocked the exit. There was only one actually gate of that enclosure on of that ground, where entry and exit was from the same gate. So General Dyer blocked only that gate. He blocked that gate and he opened fire. He fired at the people and continued firing till all his bullets were emptied. So that incident, this cruelty sent shockwaves across India. He declared later that his objective was to produce a moral effect, to create a feeling of terror in the minds of the Satyagrahis. He did not know that how many Satyagrahis were there. He did not know if there were women and children in the crowd. He just fired. He just fired upon everyone he saw. Now, as the news of Jallianwala Bagh spread, crowd took to streets in many North Indian towns. There were strikes, there were clashes with the police and attacks on government buildings. The government responded with brutal repression, seeking to humiliate and terrorize people. Satyagrahis were forced to rub their noses on the ground, crawl on the streets and salute all the white people actually. People were flogged, people were beaten up. Seeing this violence spread, Mahatma Gandhi, he actually called off this movement because he did not want violence. So, as the violence spread, Gandhi was forced to call off the Satyagraha movement. So, we are actually done up till the Jallianwala Bagh and the Daulat Act. It is done. In the next video, we will concentrate on what happens after this, what is the effect of the non-cooperation movement, what is the effect, what is the incident which led to the non-cooperation movement. We will discuss all of that in the next video. Till then, bye.